because I know for a lot of people, applying for an MFA is really stressful. I mean, applying to college in general is very stressful. But I think MFA programs, I think a lot of people are wondering, okay, well, why should I apply for an MFA program? What are the benefits? A lot of people tend to ask me, is it really worth it? Because it's very high at a lot of the programs. The tuition is not cheap. Of course, there are lots of MFA programs where you can actually get a fellowship, which will cover your tuition. And oftentimes, they'll have you do a teaching assistant position where you are covering some undergraduate courses. So there's a huge range out there of different types of MFA programs that you can enroll in. But of course, it's very complicated because there's so many factors that you have to consider. Oh, we got a question here from Amaris Joseph. Few questions. Can I show my concept art for costume design review? I'm really big into concept art. Well, Joseph, or Amaris, I'm sorry. Are you thinking about an MFA program in a particular area? Because most MFA programs tend to be in the fine arts. Sometimes there are programs in graphic design, but they're usually in painting and printmaking. Sometimes they're in new media. I know that there's like one or two graduate programs in illustration, but those don't tend to be super popular. But Amaris, you are going to be applying for fine arts. Concept art for costume design. I mean, it's hard for me to say exactly in your case because I'm not seeing the imagery, and so I can't really comment on that. But I would say in general, if it's costume design that really is being made for a particular industry, that's probably not what they're going to be looking for in an MFA program. And again, I'm sure there are exceptions to that, but it's hard for me to say exactly without seeing your work. Game art. I mean, I don't know if there are a lot of MFA programs in game design. I don't think I know of that many, at least the MFA programs that I'm familiar with. Maybe there are, they're probably a little bit less mainstream than most of the MFA programs. So I don't really know a lot about that. But if you are applying to, say, the like UPenn and Yale and Columbia and all of those top tier MFA programs, I don't think that they're going to want to see game art. That's my impression. I mean, of course, it depends on the specific school that you're talking about, but I haven't really seen programs that focus on game art. I mean, maybe if you can find one that's in new media, but the thing is, game art, I think, and game design, it's such a particular industry, and most MFA programs aren't really trying to cater to an industry like that. I could be wrong, but that's my first opinion. Yeah, Amaris, I would do some research on it. My first thought is probably a no. But again, you'll have to do some research. I mean, I think what's tricky about it is that I did my MFA a very long time ago. Like, I got my MFA in 2004, and that was 15 years ago, and a lot of things have changed quite a bit. There are some things which are pretty much the same, but I know now that more and more people every year are applying to MFAs. And I think that was not the case 30 years ago. I think the numbers of people who are applying are so much higher than they ever have been. And it's really creating somewhat of a problem in academia because a lot of people do get their MFA in order to have the credentials so they can teach at the college level. But the thing is, there are so few openings for full-time professor positions, and yet there's so many people who are getting these degrees that qualify them to do those teaching jobs. So it's sort of a numbers problem. And I think the thing about the process of applying for an MFA is you really have to ask yourself, what am I trying to get out of this experience? And there's a huge range of reasons. I mean, I think the most obvious one for a lot of people is to teach at the college level, because if you want to teach at the college level, you have to have an MFA. You can't not have an MFA and get a full-time college teaching position. So that one is very cut and dry and very obvious. But I know for a lot of students, they say maybe did not go to art school, and maybe they got their undergraduate degree at, say, a liberal arts college or a bigger university or something like that. And so maybe they have not had the opportunity to really focus full time on their studio practice. And so an MFA is maybe an opportunity to do something like that, because I think it's very hard to do that when you are not a full-time student. Like if you're trying to hold down a full-time job and also, you know, live your life at the same time, it can be very difficult to do that. And so an MFA program is a real opportunity to engage in a critical manner with other students. So that could be another reason why. And I know some people just feel like they want to do something beyond what they accomplished in their BFA programs, that they feel that the BFA program was maybe a chance to really gain a lot of technical skills and learn a lot of different things, but that maybe the BFA program, they didn't have the opportunity to really work on a project long term in much greater depth. I don't know about you guys who are watching right now, but when I was an undergraduate, and I do think this is very similar for the students that I teach right now, it's very uncommon to have a lot of time to focus on a single project. Oftentimes you're doing a new project every week, or if you do get a longer term project, it's like 2 or 3 weeks. Once in a while, there'll be a project that's maybe half the semester, but that's pretty uncommon. And so I think the thing about the BFA programs is that people can oftentimes finish them, but feel very fragmented. And so they really want a chance to just slow down and really focus. And sometimes an MFA program is a really good way to go about doing that. What I thought I would do for you guys today, and again, jump into the chat box if you guys have particular questions about MFA programs, about the application process, please feel free to pick my brain. But I wanted to show you guys the work I was doing as a senior in my undergraduate program, some of the work that I did before I went to graduate school, and some of those pieces did go into my MFA application, and then to show you some of the pieces that I did as an MFA student, because I think those are three very different stages. And I know for me, it was a really big growing process. So when I was at my undergraduate program, I was totally convinced that I was an oil painter. And so pretty much everything I did and focused on was dealing with the figure, dealing with the portrait on a large scale basis. So I was doing these very big oil paintings. I think this one was about 4 feet by 4 feet. And I was very militant about wanting to draw and paint everything from life, which I think short term helped me because I gained a lot of really important technical skills. But I now, looking back on a lot of this work, I think that actually was a big creative limitation that I probably should have removed a lot earlier. But you can see there is somewhat of a similarity to a lot of these paintings that, I mean, I look at them now and my skin wants to crawl because they're so old. And you know what it's like when you look at the work that you did like decades ago? It's sort of horrifying to do that. But at the same time, I also think that it gives you a little bit of perspective, because when I look back on these paintings, I feel that they're extremely posed, that they look like somebody arranging things and that things have been positioned in a very particular way. And I don't get the feeling that the narrative and the content is really there yet. Like, this is a self-portrait, obviously, and this was painted on the fifth floor, which was where the senior studios were, and I had everything set up. Like, the mirror that you're looking at, that was this, like, junky mirror that I picked off the street, and then I had a blue cloth set up, and the background, I painted a little bit of the ceiling and stuff like that, and occasionally I did have people posed for me. I mean, what I would usually do is I would paint the background and the other stuff when the person wasn't there, and then I would just work on them when I was when they were actually sitting there posing for me. But I mean, I look at this work now and I just like, oh my God, like what was I thinking? Like, to me, these look so much like just technical exercises. And I think to a certain degree, I think about myself as somewhat of a late bloomer in terms of my studio practice. Like, for example, when I look at a lot of the stuff that my undergraduate students are doing now, I mean, I feel like they are light years ahead of where I was. I feel like even as a senior in an undergraduate program, I was having so much trouble trying to reconcile my desire to really sharpen my technique as a figurative painter. And I really have to say, looking back at a lot of these pieces, I did not think a lot about content and about engaging with my subject matter. And I look at these and I really feel like they really were just technical exercises. And so for me, I think making that transition to the MFA level was very hard because I was so obsessed with, okay, I need to know how to paint good shadows, I need how to render form. And I actually discovered printmaking when I was a freshman in my undergraduate program, but then I started taking more printmaking classes my senior year. And so this is a lithograph that I did my senior year. And I never came back to lithography, but that was the first indication of printmaking as being part of my studio practice, and it became very significant later on. And so I think the advice I would give you guys, if you're an undergrad right now or if you're out of school, don't make any assumptions about where you think you want to be, because I totally applied to the MFA programs under the impression that, yes, I would be going into an MFA program in painting. I'm going to continue the work that I've been doing. That's how it's going to be. And now that I look back on it, I don't really understand why I had such a narrow-minded point of view of what my MFA program experience was going to be. I mean, it's one of those things where, you know, when you look back on your history and development as an artist, I look at some of my stuff and I just wish I could scrap it all and do it all over again. I mean, I think that's sort of typical for a lot of artists, that we are frequently not satisfied with the work that we do. And so there's always this urge to want to redo things. So I think that I was thinking about some things as an undergrad, but it all felt very scatterbrained. It was very fragmented. Everything was a one-off. It was like, okay, well, this print is about this theme. This print is about another theme. I never really spent a very long, sustained period of time really thinking deeply about an idea. I was more just jumping around and trying all these different techniques. So then later on, I started realizing that I did want to go to grad school eventually, but I didn't want to go right away. And that's actually advice that I give to a lot of my students now, is I tell them, look, don't go straight into an MFA program from the BFA program, because the timing is not good. Like, if you're a senior right now in an undergraduate program, okay, it's October now, your applications would be due next February, which is actually only in a few months. And I can tell you that when I was a senior in an undergraduate program, I was not ready to be applying or starting something new. I really needed to just clear my head a little bit. I don't know about you guys who are in undergraduate programs right now, whether you feel oversaturated with content or if you feel that you're hungry for more, but I felt very oversaturated. Like, in my undergraduate program, we got so much critique, and certainly that was one of the best things about my art school experience. But honestly, by the time I was a senior, I was just ready to like turn off all the critique voices and just be by myself in my own head for a little while. And so for me, at least from a mindset standpoint, I just needed a break. I needed like a year away from art school. And art school, I think, is very intense in that you're almost like living on top of each other, like you're seeing the same people every day. And I just needed some distance from that. So I graduated my undergraduate program thinking to myself, I'm going to take at least a year off. The thing is, though, for me, a year didn't really feel like enough, because it's a huge transition graduating from an undergraduate program. And at least for me, I really was struggling for a while trying to figure out, well, how do I balance having a job and making sure I have enough to eat while also creating my own studio practice? And I'll be honest with you guys, and I'll tell you, it took a while. I mean, it took me longer than a year to figure that out. I mean, I think to a certain degree, I'm always trying to figure out a better work-life balance, but I can tell you when I was like 23, I did not know what I was doing. And I look back on that time period, and I just think, oh my God, what was I thinking? I did all these stupid things. I mean, now it's like, I still struggle with it, but it's not a problem. It's not something that I think about or that I'm really troubleshooting a lot. It's like, you're always adjusting, but they're very cosmetic changes. So for me, it was really hard, because when I got out of undergrad, I just ended up sort of repeating what I already had been doing as an undergrad. Like, I was doing some portrait paintings, I was doing life drawing at some life drawing sessions with models, and I was drawing in my sketchbook, but nothing substantial. A lot of it was just a sketch here, a sketch there. I mean, a big part of it was that I was working full time. I was teaching at this after school program, and then later I got a job teaching at an elementary school, and I just was wiped out at the end of the day, and I just couldn't hold down a job and stay up all night the way I did in art school. So that was a really big transition. But eventually I did sort of learn my lesson, and I think for me the big game changer was that I bought a miniature printing press. I remember it was not that expensive. It was like $500. I mean, for me that at the time, that was a really big investment. Like, I was not used to spending that much money on it. And I remembered that my freshman year as an undergrad, I'd taken this intaglio printmaking course, and I thought, you know, I could actually do some intaglio prints, and I could do dry point so that I don't have to bother with acid and processing and toxic materials. And I literally just had this baby printmaking press in my living room, and that's where I started creating these dry point prints. And I think this was the big difference, where I really started to focus, and I created what I really considered to be my first professional body of work that was not in the context of a school structure. And these are small prints. I mean, these prints you guys are looking at here, this is probably like 5 inches by 4 inches. And so I was thinking about the skeletal structure of these almost warped figures that I was thinking about. And here's another one. And I did a lot of these. And this was the first time that I had ever really created a major series. And so even though I look at this work that I did between the BFA program and the MFA program, and I just, my skin crawls. I don't like any of this work. I still think it was important for me to have that experience, because the difference is that when I got out of my MFA program, I knew exactly what I needed to do to get a job, to start up my exhibition practice again. And my friends who went straight from an MFA right into an MFA, they had never really hunted for a job before. They'd never exhibited professionally before. I mean, granted, it's not like I exhibited at some amazing places between my BFA and MFA, but at the very least, I understood what the process was. And so I definitely think that taking those 4 years off in between the BFA program, super helpful, because when I got out, I just knew exactly what to do. I didn't have to have that awkward transition period. It was just a lot faster. And then the other thing is that on top of that, all of a sudden I had an MFA, and this whole world of college teaching opened up to me. And of course, that was not an option before I had my MFA. And so there are a lot of advantages to that. So anyway, if you guys are just joining us, I'd love for you to pop into the chat box, ask me any questions you have about the MFA process. I'm just showing people some of the work that I did in between my BFA and my MFA program, because I just felt like after my undergraduate program, I really wanted to just try it. I just wanted to be out there. I wanted to try being an artist and see what happened. I didn't have any major plans. The only real thing that I think was important to me after my BFA program was that I was on my own. So I didn't live at home. I lived in a crummy little apartment in Boston and, you know, lived on very little, and it was fine. I'm not complaining about it at all. I mean, I had very few expenses at the time because I didn't have kids or anything like that. But I think for me, I had to prove my independence as an adult first before I felt that I could really move onto the MFA program. And then I also, these figure paintings that I'm showing you now, these are part of my MFA portfolio. This is a long time ago, by the way, you guys. This is from like 2002. Yes, I am old, okay? But these are some of the paintings that I used to apply to an MFA. Okay, Brandon Jean is saying, how skilled technically do you need to be able to apply for an MFA program? Brandon, do you mean in terms of more representational versions of painting, like how to paint a figure or a portrait? Because I think a lot of people have different definitions of having technical skill, or whether you have to be very well versed in bronze casting, or you have to know how to do plaster waste molds. So if you can be a little more specific in your question, that would help me. But I will answer the way that I think you're asking. I don't think that an MFA program is really about technical skill. I think the larger part of the MFA program experience is learning how to engage critically with your work. So what you'll find is that at the undergraduate level, there tends to be more emphasis on technical skills because in a BFA program, people are coming in with almost no experience because they're coming out of high school usually, and so they usually don't know how to do basic skills like casting or oil painting. I mean, I didn't really know how to do any of that until I got to undergrad. But then in an MFA program, they're going to really want to see that you're doing something that is beyond a classroom exercise. So if you guys are applying for an MFA, you're not going to want to fill your whole portfolio with a figure drawing and a still life and a gouache painting that is an exercise in design. I mean, they don't really want to see a patchwork quilt collection of all of your paintings from the various classes you did as an undergrad. That is not going to get you into an MFA program because they want to see that you're doing more than that. Okay, so Brandon is saying, I did mean more representational figures in still lifes. I think, Brandon, it really depends on the school you apply to. I can tell you that some of the more prestigious programs like Columbia and Yale are not going to care so much about that. There's other programs where I think that is a bigger priority. I think the best way to figure out if it is important or not to that school, look at the student artwork. See what work is being made right now by the MFA students. And if you see that there is a pattern of lots of technical skill in terms of figures and still lives, then probably yes, it probably is a priority. But if you look at some other programs, you will see that those skills and representation are not that important and that people are more concerned about other aspects of the work. I mean, to me, learning how to paint representationally in terms of like learning the basics of light and shadow and how to paint skin tone and anatomy and all that, to me, that belongs more in an undergraduate program. There are exceptions for sure. I mean, I know some people go to like ateliers, although those are not MFA programs, it's sort of a different thing altogether, but it's sort of case by case. And again, I think it also depends on why you're going to the graduate program. I know for some people, an MFA is not worth it because for some people, they just need time to practice. And you have to learn to distinguish the difference between needing time to practice your skill set and wanting to engage critically, because those are two very different things. You don't have to go to an MFA program, I think, to learn all those skills. I think if you go to an undergrad program, you get basic foundations in terms of how to paint and draw representationally. A lot of that's just a matter of time and practice, but learning how to really investigate your content and learning to question where your work belongs in a contemporary landscape, that is really what the MFA is a lot more for. So they're not going to care about like, oh, wow, can you paint that apple accurately? That's not going to be a big priority at an MFA program, unless it's an MFA program that really is focused on that. And most of them are not. So that would be my first thought. But let me show you guys some of the work that I was doing when I was actually at my MFA program, because I actually really feel like I learned a lot because I took a less traditional route in that initially I really thought I was going to do an MFA in painting. And I have to admit, I was a little traumatized by my admissions experience with MFA programs. And I just want to warn you guys that if you don't get in the first time you apply, that is not because you're a terrible artist. It's because the numbers are working against you. It's just there's so many people applying and there's so few openings for MFA programs. It's just really, really hard to get in. And so I would just say, if you guys are applying to an MFA program for the first time, just don't tell yourself that you have to get in that first year. I have a lot of former students who have told me that they've applied 2-3 years in a row And that the reason they did that is because they really wanted to make sure the program they got into was a good fit. There is nothing wrong with that. And so don't tell yourself that you have to get in that first year. I really wish I'd said that to myself. I don't know why I didn't ever entertain that idea. I guess I just didn't occur to me at the time. I had a very linear way of thinking about school. And I don't know, I think part of me probably felt somewhat of an urgency to go because I had been out of school for 4 years at the time, and I didn't really feel like I had the luxury to wait another year. I mean, I did, I just didn't see it that way. It's just very hard to think through all those things when you have so much going on. But anyway, this sculpture you guys are looking at here, this was my MFA thesis project. And my thesis project, it was largely this sculpture installation that I created. And you guys can see here, this is another view. The figures are smaller than life size. They're not tiny. I'd say they're probably like, well, they're probably like half life size. So I would think that maybe if one of these figures stood up, it'd probably be like 3 feet tall. So they're not that gigantic, but they're big enough that they took up a lot of space for sure. So this was, for me, a big departure because I ended up doing my MFA in sculpture, and I really felt very disoriented because I was going to an MFA program with a lot of people who did degrees in sculpture, who had a lot of experience. And so for me, that was actually, I think, a really good learning experience because I did feel that I was very behind, and I had a couple of peers who were extremely generous about their time, and they helped me so much learning a lot of the technical skills in terms of casting, in terms of modeling. So I feel lucky that I had some peers who were willing to do that. And then here you can see a detail. You can get a better sense of the texture and surface of some of these figures. And actually, to explain very briefly, these figures were actually created out of plaster waste molds. So it's hard to explain. I'm not going to get into the whole thing now because it's difficult to describe in a lot of detail, but essentially a plaster waste mold is a process where you take a piece that's made out of ceramic clay or maybe porcelain clay, and then in the process of making that cast, you actually end up destroying the mold in the process. So if you've never done a plaster waste mold before, it's actually very stressful because if you mess up your waste mold, you can actually lose everything. And I saw people have that experience where they did something totally wrong. The whole thing just fell apart. They lost the sculpture, they lost the mold, and that was the end. So waste molds are very good to do if you really know how to do them well, because they can be much less time consuming and a lot cheaper by a lot than having something cast in, say, bronze or something like that. But there is that danger if you're not very skilled. So if you guys take a look at this, the white rocks that the figures are actually digging into, those are actually the waste molds that I use to cast these pieces. So in a sense, I really thought about these figures as digging into their own shells, like they're digging into the rubble that they emerged from themselves. And so I really liked that relationship between these figures really digging and searching into a material that they really emerged from to begin with. But actually, when I think about it and I look at this work, I think the work that really started to define the type of work I do now is more the prints that I did in association with this project. So I'll show you guys a couple of those. So graduate school is where I really learned how to do monotype. I had never done it before, and it was easy to learn because monotype is like for lazy printmakers. It's just so easy. Like, you just take a sheet of plexiglass, you slap on some paint, maybe you roll it on, you roll it through the press, you're done. The thing about a monotype is you can only print it one time. You cannot do multiples the way you can with other printmaking techniques, but I loved the painterly aspect of it. And these monotypes that I'm showing you guys here, these are really big. I think they're something like 2 feet by 3 feet. And then if you add the border, they're even bigger than that. So these prints were very exciting for me because I was doing them in conjunction with the sculpture installation. But when I think about the work I'm doing now, the sculpture installation really faded from my practice and the prints became very significant. So it's very odd because when I think about my BFA degree, which is actually an illustration, I'm not an illustrator at all, and then my MFA was in sculpture, I do use sculpture today, but I don't really use it as a final product. I use sculpture a lot as a way of sketching through my ideas. Oftentimes, I will sculpt a sculpture so that way it can be a reference object for my drawings. And so I always find it very funny that the one area that I really feel I've done most of my professional work in is printmaking. And yet I don't have anything on paper that officially says I'm a printmaker. I don't have a degree in printmaking at all. And so I think sometimes people look at my work today and they look at my CV and they're like, what, BFA in illustration, MFA in sculpture? It doesn't seem like it makes a lot of sense. But I think that's okay. I don't think that you have to get an MFA necessarily in the area that you end up doing. I mean, you may not know what you're going to be doing later on, but I do know that sculpture became very important to me later on. Like, I used to draw a lot from photos, like especially these monotypes that I'm showing you. I used reference images of people digging, people in ditches and things like that, and I just would get them offline and I would sort of collage them together so I could create a composition. And so that process worked for a little while. But after a little bit, I realized that I didn't like the photos because they felt so inflexible. And so I actually ended up sculpting a lot of figures out of clay. And that was so much better because I could really just rotate the sculptures and look at them from any point of view. And I don't think I would have discovered that had I not done an MFA program. I think if I just kept working on my own and hadn't done the MFA program, I don't think I would have grown as much. I don't think I would have taken as many risks. Because I do think the thing about an MFA program is that it is a real commitment. It is something that you have to really give yourself to. And I think most people who do enroll in MFA programs are pretty serious at that point. I mean, you're not going to screw around, especially when the tuition is so high. So I think it's not a matter of, oh, do you have the work ethic or something? It's just a matter of, well, what do you do with that time? I think that's the important thing. So I also got really into woodcut in my MFA program. And this, again, very big piece of, actually, this was probably like three pieces of wood. I think I had to laminate them together because I couldn't find a sheet of poplar that was big enough. But these are also 24 inches by 36 inches. And I just loved how muscular this process was because what I would do is I would screw the woodcut block to the wall and I had this like giant wood mallet and a huge chisel and I just would go at it. It was great. It was almost like a total physical workout. But I think what I learned at the MFA level is how to go deeper with my subject matter because the theme here in these woodcuts and prints I'm showing you was digging. But the thing is, I started to realize that there were multiple interpretations of this idea of digging, that there were so many associations with it. And that was the first time in my life that I ever remember being more excited about the subject than about the technical execution. And I started thinking less about the technique and more about the content. Now, given this was back when I like never thought about content or subject matter. So it wasn't like a huge improvement necessarily, but for me it was because I hadn't really learned as an undergrad how to really think about my subject and how to hone it and develop it. And I remember I just did so much research. Like I just gathered like hundreds and hundreds of images of people digging in all different types of situations. There was tons and tons of sketching. And I'd never done that degree of research for a project before. I feel like what I was doing as a BFA student felt like I was really skimming the surface. And a lot of that is because as an undergrad student, you're taking tons of classes, you're trying all types of different things. And so for me, the MFA program that I went to was very important because it gave me a level of focus that I didn't have before, and it really paved the way for the way that I work today. And certainly the way I work today has changed quite a bit, but I think for me, it was worth it. I mean, for me, I really had to do the MFA program because I was really committed to teaching and I really wanted to make sure that I had the degree so I could teach at the college level. But I think if you're going to bother doing all that, you might as well create a professional body of work while you're at it. And I just remember thinking back about those skull drawings, which I'll show you guys again in case some of you guys missed it. So these skull drawings that I was doing, these figure paintings, these are the pieces I did in between my BFA and my MFA. These, oh my God, felt so shallow. They felt like they were just about looking odd. And I honestly, if you'd asked me at the time what these paintings and these skulls were really about, I probably would have just said to you, I think they look cool. And that doesn't cut it for me anymore. And I get on my undergraduate students about that. I say, look, why are you doing this? What is your motivation? Tell me what that is. And the whole answer, well, I think it looks cool, that's not going to fly at the professional level, especially if you want to get out there and show your work in different contexts. I mean, there certainly is a whole world of people who just want to look at cool stuff, but I think if you really want your work to have a certain level of depth, I think that that's very important. All right, so if you guys have questions about the MFA process, that's what we're talking about today, about applying for an MFA program, what's involved, what the experience is like, please jump into the chat box. I'm going to give you guys like 5 more minutes to do that. So I'll continue chatting about some basics. And we do review, as I was saying earlier, we do review BFA portfolios and MFA portfolios. And a lot of people will ask me sometimes, well, what's the difference between a BFA portfolio and an MFA portfolio? And they could not be more different. I feel like an MFA and a BFA portfolio, it's like opposite ends of the spectrum. I think a BFA portfolio, you are trying to show your willingness to experiment, to be able to wear lots of hats that are different, to try on different identities. Whereas I would expect at the MFA level that people are not done experimenting, but have started to buckle down and focus more. All right, so Brandon is saying, were there any specific exercises you did in your MFA to get more into the context or depth in your professional work? Brandon, are you talking about specific exercises like in terms of drawing and painting, or are you talking about just activities in general? I mean, I think a big part of the MFA program is getting to speak to a lot of working artists and professionals. And also for me, I went to graduate school in New York. And so that was also important because I feel like by living there, I got a better gist of the New York City art scene. I visited a lot of galleries. And I know that if I had gone to a graduate school that was somewhere else, I never would have had that opportunity. And I know for me, New York City was very intimidating for a long time. Like I was like, was terrified of New York City because it was so big and gigantic and I didn't really know where to start. And I have to say, I was pleasantly surprised by New York. I don't really want to live there right now because it costs an arm and a leg to live there. But I really think that was a good experience as an artist. And I think that if you have the opportunity to live in New York at any point, it is a great experience as an artist just to be there, just watching the scene in general. And I think really, Brandon, the way to get into the context of professional work, I think for me, it was that 4-year period in between my BFA and MFA where I was not in school and I just was submitting my work to shows. I was getting into some group shows. I was talking to other artists. I was trying out the scene in Boston and things like that. Boston felt better for me because, number one, I'm from that area and I just did not have the money to move to a place like New York. I know a lot of art school students, undergrads, they sometimes feel a lot of pressure from people to move to New York City right away. And that works for some people, that's fine. But I think we all know New York City is not cheap. I mean, you can pay a lot of money for an apartment that is like a closet. So I think that it depends on the person. Some people are fine with that, some people are not. But I actually have been telling a lot of my students, look, you guys don't have to move to New York. You can move to another city that's much less expensive and you probably will be able to afford a studio. Whereas in New York City, you really have to make a pretty significant amount of money to, number one, rent a studio, much less have the time to actually use it. And so I say to students, just spend like a few years in another city, save up some money, get some professional experience, and then when you go to New York City, it's not going to be so scary. And that's basically what I did, because I was out of school for 4 years and then I moved to New York. And so it wasn't so frightening at the time. I don't know, maybe I'm just a big wimp. But for me, New York City just felt really intimidating. So I had to get some experience somewhere else. Not like Boston is cheap, but it felt more familiar to me because I'm from that area. But I think a big part of it is recognizing at the MFA and the BFA level how important your professional contacts are, because I have a couple of former professors from my undergrad program who are my colleagues now, and a lot of them helped me a lot in terms of my career. And I think the advice I would give you guys is you can't be an artist on your own. You have to have a support system. You have to have mentors who are going to help you. And my feeling right now as an adjunct professor is that it's my job to pass that on, because somebody else helped me when I was in that position, and I need to help the students who need the same type of help that somebody else gave me. And so it's this passing things forward, which I think is very, very important. So just so you guys know, if you want more information about MFA portfolios, we are working on a section on artprof.org that is going to give you guys lots of information about MFA programs, about portfolios. I'm hoping to interview some students of mine, former students who are currently in MFA programs or who finished one recently. So hopefully we'll get that together for you guys. And Lauren Welch, who was supposed to be on the stream tonight, but her laptop melted down, so she couldn't do it today. But I'm hoping to get her on the stream as well, because Lauren is actually going to be an MFA student very soon. And she has a much more up-to-date version of what the MFA process is like, because she just went through it like last year. So hopefully you guys can pick her brain about that. And reminder, remember, we do review portfolios. So if you are applying for an MFA this year and you want to get a professional opinion about how you're doing, you can go to this link. We do charge a fee, just so you guys know, and you can get all this information in the video description below. And then lastly, I'd encourage you guys to support ArtProf on Patreon, because we want to keep ArtProf alive. And to do that, to keep giving you guys free content all the time, we need a budget. And remember, artprof.org, our site, which is up here, that's the URL, we're totally free. You can look at all of our video tutorials. We have tons of video critiques. We've got portfolio critiques. You don't have to pay a dime to access any of that. And that's always been very important to me, to keep our profile, our platform very accessible. But to do that, we need some financial support. So I hope you guys will consider supporting us. Thank you to those of you who do currently support us. You can make a monthly donation. You can do it on a one-time donation on PayPal. So please keep that in mind. We greatly appreciate that. Thank you so much for tuning in, and I'll see you guys next time.